Hello and welcome! It's Friday and this means it's video time. Today we're talking about a really nice feature or a really nice service at the Microsoft Azure Cloud. But before we start, I'd like to give you a short introduction about me. My name is Hannes Lagler-Grüner. I'm a multi-cloud architect in one of the biggest consulting companies in Austria. You can find my social footprint on different areas like Twitter, Xing, LinkedIn, Facebook. I also have a private blog called cloudblogger.at and for sure now the private YouTube channel. I'm working a long time with public cloud. In the beginning, I'm starting with Microsoft Azure Cloud. This is my focusing area. And over the time, I'm realizing it's a good idea to go broader and also specialize into AWS and GCP too. Today we have a really interesting new topic named Azure Virtual WAN in Action. This is from video type full session and from video category level 300. So a little bit more into details. So let's go ahead and talk about the agenda from today. First of all, we have to discuss, okay, the challenges from today. When customers are going to the cloud, what are their challenges from network perspective? Based on this network perspective, I want to demonstrate a use case. Also, I want to show you, I want to discuss with you, okay, what is Virtual WAN and how can Virtual WAN help you to achieve your use case? Where is the availability of Azure Virtual WAN? And at the end of the demo session, I want to show you my demo architecture. And based on this demo architecture, I want to hand over to a live demo where you can see how Azure Virtual WAN is working in real life. Okay, the challenges from today. The first topic is not based on cloud only. Many customers have maybe one or more headquarters and maybe one or more branch offices, regional based or global based. So this is the base area. Based on this decision, the customers have to think about, okay, we need a regional or global network. And this network have to achieve some topics. First of all, it has to be a constant connection, it has to be secure, and it has to be easy to develop and to deploy. In some cases, when the customer is growing, it has to be flexible, and from management perspective, it has to be inexpensive for sure. Okay, let's talk about the traditional ways, what you can do in the old way to achieve these topics. The first traditional way is site-to-site VPN. It's secure, yes, we have an IPsec tunnel. It's easy to configure, yes, site-to-site is not really hard to configure. It is inexpensive, it depends. Because it depends on the customer hardware, what we need, and also, and this is the important part, also on the customer connections. So if the customer have a bad connection in their location, it could be really expensive to get more connectivity or more bandwidth. It's flexible, also depends on the connectivity area and also on the hardware equipment. Fast, yes, for sure, from deployment side, it's really fast, so it's not really hard to deploy a site-to-site VPN connection, connectivity. But from connection perspective, in some situations, it's not really fast. And constant, for sure, no. So when you have one connection, one single internet provider, you have no high availability. So when the internet provider is going down, the connection is going down. Also, the connectivity to your headquarter from your branch office site is going down. So go one step ahead and talk about MPLS. MPLS is the second option that you have in the past. So it's constant, yes, for sure. It's secure, yes, we have also a secure connectivity here. It's easy from customer side, it's really easy. So you talk with your provider and this provider gives you the endpoint and you have to plug your network environment and you are connected. It's real easy from customer's perspective. It's fast. It depends. So if you pay more money, you get a faster connection for sure. From deployment perspective, it's not really fast because you have to have an to open a ticket to your provider, and this provider have in some situations need up to 4 or 5 months, whatever, to create your connection or to build your connection on your branch office site. The last 2 points, definitely no. It's not inexpensive. It's really, really expensive, this connectivity from international perspective. Flexible, no, because you have a provider binding and long contracts. So you have no ability to say, okay, today I'm creating a new MPLS connection with this provider and next week I'm creating a MPLS connection with another provider. It's not really so easy to implement. Okay, about this, let's talk about the use case. We have a use case, we have a customer with one headquarter, 4 branch offices, and the customer is growing up and get more branch offices. We have a central connection, we have low latency and low bandwidth. This is our goal. At the moment, it's not really achieved because in some branch offices, we have 200 milliseconds latency and 20 megabit, for example, bandwidth. But in some branch offices, it's really, really bad. 400 milliseconds and 5 megabit is a really bad connectivity. What we can do, we can use the public cloud, the Azure cloud for this use case, to use the cloud possibilities. So we have a central administration inside Microsoft Azure. It's fast and easy. Yes, for sure. We can use this and grow up the connectivity up to 20 gigabit. So it depends on your internet provider. And you also have the ability to use a site-to-site VPN, or what we can see here in the headquarter area, an express route. So this is a dedicated connection from your headquarter to the Azure cloud. And inside the Azure cloud, we have a centralized configuration and also a central routing area and transit network. So, depending on this goal, what is Azure Virtual WAN? Azure Virtual WAN is a global service which centralized network security and routing functionalities. On top, you also have a central monitoring solution, which have the ability to monitor each connection, each branch office connection, or each headquarter connection. It's based on a hub and spoke architecture, and you also have the possibility to achieve a global transit network. So if you're a customer, a global-based customer, and have branch offices around the world, you have the ability, when you're using a standard virtual WAN hub, you have the ability to connect each hub together and get a global transit network. So in the next picture, we can see this architecture. We have here now a hub-to-hub connection. It's based on a standard virtual WAN hub. And you can see we have 2 regions, region 1 and region 2. And region 1 and region 2 is connected over the hub-to-hub connection. And this is using the Microsoft Azure backend. This is an early important part. And then at the bottom, you can see, okay, we have here an express route connected to our headquarter. We also have a branch office connected over site-to-site VPN and the second branch office connected in region one. And all branch offices can connect together. And on the right side, we can see one new feature. We have the ability to use point-to-site VPN. At the current situation, it's really important to have this option because in COVID-19 time, many customers or many staffs are working from home office. So you need a point-to-site VPN connection. You have your company device and you have to connect to your company network over your home office. And this is the ability to use point-to-site VPN. Okay, from the connectivity perspective, we have here a good picture. You can see we have a full transit with network based on Microsoft Azure. So the headquarter have the ability to connect to branch office in region one and also to each branch office in region two. And for sure, the branch offices also have the same capabilities. Okay, so let's go ahead and talk about the ability. Where can I use this Azure Virtual WAN connectivity? You can see here the official Microsoft data center map, and you can see in nearly all data centers, you have the ability to use Azure Virtual WAN. There are some data centers where the service is not available, but I guess in the near future, it's available in each data center. For sure, the service is not available in announced data center because the data center are not there. Okay, then let's go ahead and we are nearly at the end from our theory session. Let's talk about the architecture from our demo environment. We have two regions. One region is in East US. The second region is in West Europe. We have a hub-to-hub connection. So we have those two hubs connected. We also have a branch office in East US. It's a demo environment, so this branch office is located in AWS, and in AWS we have a FortiGate firewall and also a virtual machine located. We also have on the West Europe side two branch offices connected. One branch office is the West Europe side, also based in AWS, and the hub in Microsoft Azure, and the UK side is also in AWS and have on those branch offices have two virtual machines in each area. But here is an interesting part because the connection from UK to West Europe is primarily a direct connection. So we have a site-to-site VPN between those branch offices, and if you have if a connection failed, so for example, your provider have a problem or the firewall VPN have a problem, you have a fallback over Azure Virtual WAN. And in my demo, later on, I will demonstrate the failover. So this is, you can see it in the ICMP ping, that the primary connection is going down, and with no downtime, you have a failover to the Azure Virtual WAN hub. We also have in each area an Azure virtual network located, so this is also connected. We also have there our virtual machines, and we have in this case a global transit and also a full mesh VPN. Okay, let's go ahead and talk about the live demo. First of all, I want to show you Azure Virtual WAN. What is Azure Virtual WAN? Then we are going one step further and talking about the automation possibilities for Virtual WAN. Then we have the connectivity test, so speed and latency tests. Also the failover test for Virtual WAN in UK and West Europe. And at the end, I will show you the monitoring capabilities about Azure Virtual One. Okay, let's hand over to our live demo. Now you can see I'm in my Azure portal. Inside my Azure portal, you can see I'm in the home area. And now I'm switched to my Virtual One section. But before I do this, I want to show you the resource group where the resources are available. So I have here a separate resource group named, I'm the wrong subscription. So let's switch to the right one. I have here my Virtual One demo area. And inside this area, you can see, okay, I have my Virtual One service in place. I also have a log analytics service in place and two virtual network, one based in East US and another one based in West Europe. Okay, this is all what you need in this case. So let's switch to the Virtual One service. First of all, you can see a live map representing your Virtual One hubs. In my case, I have only two Virtual One hubs, one in East US and one in West Europe located. On the bottom side, you can see also the name from the Virtual One hub, the status, the IP address space from the Virtual One hub, and the VPN connections, ExpressRoute connections, and site-to-site VPN connections. Okay, on the left side, on the menu side, you can see activity log. So this is normal. Each service has an activity log. Access control EM. So you have custom role-based access controls based on Virtual One. Also have the tagging option. And now this is the interesting part. We have a configuration section. So depending on your Virtual One type, you can enable or disable the branch-to-branch or hub-to-hub connection. So hub-to-hub is per default enabled, and branch-to-branch is this case is also enabled because I want a full connected environment. Each branch office can connect to each other. This is only possible, the hub-to-hub connectivity, when you use Azure Virtual One from type standard. Okay, first what we have to do, we have now Virtual One in place, the service is in place. Next point is we have to create a connectivity. The first connectivity is, or the first section is, we have to create a Virtual One hub. In this case, I've created a Virtual One hub in East Europe and in East US too. I want to show you only one area. So I have here my West Europe Virtual One hub. I have here the private IP address space, which is required for Virtual One only. We have here our connections. In this case, I have also a VNet connection. So this connection means I have a virtual network inside Azure with VM connections, and I'm connecting this virtual network to Virtual One hub. And this is this connection here. Next, I have two virtual VPN connections from type site to site. And you can see here, okay, I have two connections. And I have also a VPN point to site connection. Also one connection. I don't have any ExpressRoute connection or Azure Firewall. I will cover this later on. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look to my VPN site-to-site connection. Inside VPN site-to-site, I want to give you the information. We have a full BGP configuration inside Virtual One Hub. This is the reason why I have here my ASN number. And I also have my BGP configuration in place. You can see here, I can implement a separate gateway configuration. I don't change anything in this case, but let's take a look on it. We have here the public IP address. Every time when you deploy a new Virtual One hub, you will always get two VPN gateway instances behind the scenes. So this is important. So you have the ability to to connect to each of these virtual WAN gateways. Each of this, a separate public IP address and also a private IP address, and for sure an BGP IP address. You can define a specified BGP address, a custom BGP address, but in this case, I leave the default. And on the top, you can see the gateway scale units. In my case, I'm deployed one gateway scale unit. So this means I have 400 megabit for each VPN gateway instance available. So we can scale up this up to 20 scale units, which means 10 gigabit per each VPN instance. Okay. So let's go ahead and take a look to my connections. You can see here, I have two connections. So when we take a look to our demo, to our slide, we have two connections. We have a connection in East US, in West Europe, and we have a connection from UK. We also have a connection, a primary connection between UK and between UK and West Europe, and each location is also connected to Virtual WAN. We also have for sure a connection from East US to a separate Virtual WAN, and this is connected over a branch-to-branch connection. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look to our connection. Inside the connection, you can see what is the link name, what is the provider, in this case, my Fortinet environment, what is the link speed, 250 megabit, the private link address from my firewall, from the on-premise firewall, my BGP address, and the ESN, which I want to use. Okay, the same is here in Western Europe, but I want to show you an interesting part. So we have a full BGP environment. So when I take a look to our routing tables, we have defined, we are using the default routing table. The name is default. And inside this default routing tables, we can see, one moment, so here, it takes some time, we can see all routes from the Asia cloud, from on-premise, from the Asia virtual network. We can always see it inside this route table. So you can see, okay, my next hop for site-to-site VPN gateway from this IP address space, in this case, this is my point-to-site. You can see, okay, this is from West Europe hub. Also for my 10.0/13.2.0/24, it's also based on my VPN gateway. You can see here my EC now path, and also if you are connected some network from some virtual networks, you can see it also here. Okay, so let's go ahead and take a look to our user VPN connection. So I also have an point-to-site VPN in place because my client, I'm now connected to my company environment, and I'm connected over point-to-site. In this case, I have also deployed one scale unit from 500 megabytes, and it supports up to 500 client sessions. We can define here a separate DNS server, and I can see, okay, now one connected client is available. And this is my client. I can show you the connection type. You can see here I'm using Asia Virtual WAN VPN client. And the cool feature here is I'm connected over Asia Active Directory. So this means I have my username, my password, and for my second factor, I can use my phone authenticator, I can use SMS, a phone call, a FIDO2 key, whatever I want. So I have an Asia ID connection, and I can also use I can also use for sure. Man, I don't know the name right now. Conditional access, I'm sorry for that, yes. Conditional access, so this is the important part here. From security perspective, I can use username, password, and the second factor. And to handle this connection, I have conditional access in place to set my security features. Okay, now we have here the ability to use to convert the hub to a secure hub. So normally the hub are connected over the Microsoft backend, and the connection is a routing-based connection, so there is no separate encryption on top. But you can do this if you want. You can convert your virtual WAN to a secure hub. And this means, okay, you can provision an Azure firewall. From my point of view, it's the best solution because it's a PaaS system. Everything is managed by Microsoft, and you have to configure the options. But you can also use, if you want, a third-party provider based on Zscaler, Check Point, or IBOS. It depends on you. My customers always use the normal configuration, so hub-to-hub connection for sure, but not a secure hub on top. In some cases, it could be a good reason. Okay, so now we are connected. We have connected each environment, and now I want to show you the connection itself. So here you can see I'm connected to each computer. So I have one VM based on East US 2. So this is my environment inside the US. I have two connections in UK, and I have one connections in Western Europe. First of all, I want to ping from East US my VM in West Europe. So keep in mind, you can see here, sorry. You can see here the connection is between West Europe and East US. So we can see here one VM in East US, one VM in UK, and one VM in West Europe. I have always two connections available, open. So keep in mind, in my demo, you can see here, I'm sorry, wrong one. You can see here my connection between East US and Western Europe. So let's take a look to the action perspective. So I'm now connected, and I can see here, test, okay, my ping connectivity from to 10.11.0.74, and this is my VM based in Western Europe. So the ping time is 138 milliseconds. It's okay. So now I'm testing the connectivity between UK and West Europe. I also ping the same IP address, and it's 10 up to 11 milliseconds. And on this VM, I ping back to the East US VM, 10.12.0.110. And I have approx 138, 39 milliseconds. Okay, that's fine. Everything is connected to each other. Perfect. Now I want to show you a bandwidth test. All right, I've installed into my VMs IPERF3, and now I'm testing the connectivity or the bandwidth between East US and West Europe. Okay, 24, 49, nearly 100 megabit per second between East US and West Europe. Now I'm testing the connectivity between UK and West Europe. It's 1.5 gigabyte or more. And this is why is this so heavy? Because I'm provisioned a virtual WAN hub with 500 megabit. the reason for that is I have a direct connectivity. So my two locations are connected directly. And I want to show you now, disable the connectivity. So I have here a postman command and I disable my connection, my direct connection between West Europe and East US. And take a look to our ICMP ping. This will change because now we have 10 milliseconds and I'm now shutting down the connectivity. And you can see now it's down and we are flapping up to 20 milliseconds, 25 milliseconds. We have no downtime. And now I can test the IPv3 connection once more. Now I'm between 200 and 400 megabit per second. Now I want to fail back. So it takes some time because there are some rules inside Fortinet to check if the connectivity is stable. And after some seconds, the milliseconds will go down to, I will go back to 10 milliseconds. Now the connectivity is between firewall UK and West Europe over a direct connection. Okay, perfect. This is the ICMP time. This is the transfer bandwidth. It's an awesome product. So let's take a look or let's talk about monitoring. We have now our connectivity between each location and now we have to monitor those connectivity. We have here inside VirtualWAN a nice feature called Insights. So let's take a look to this option. We can see here the metrics are fetching. And now, make it a little bit bigger. So you can see here, refresh the connection. Come on. Yes, everything is working. You can see here our VirtualWAN hub, also VirtualWAN service. The two VirtualWAN hubs, one hub is located in West Europe. The second one hub is located in East US. We can see here our two VPN gateways, one for the site-to-site VPN connection, one for the point-to-site VPN connection, and one direct connection between VirtualWAN hub and your network located in East in Asia. And here you can see each connection endpoints, UK, West Europe, everything is working fine, everything is okay. And then we take a look to the metrics itself. You can see here we have the VirtualWAN hubs. We also have a bandwidth, an average bandwidth from our site-to-site VPN and also from our point-to-site VPN. If we are using, we can also see here our ExpressRoute connection. Okay, that's perfect. We have without any configuration, this map here in place and have an end-to-end topology about our virtual network connection. Perfect. So the second part here is to monitor and to get an alert if something goes wrong. So let's take a look to another service named Network Watcher. And I've prepared here the service for my demo. So let's take a look to Connection Monitor. And here you can see I've created an connection monitor, VirtualWAN monitoring, and you can see here I have an endpoint, port 22, and here you can see I have different endpoints. I'm now checking the one VM in East US 2, and I also check on port 22 my VM in UK, West Europe, and East US. Everything is okay, and if something goes wrong, I have here an alert metric. And this alert metric will send me an email if something goes wrong. That's a perfect solution. It's everything inside Asia. The whole configuration is inside Asia. And the good part here is we can use automation for each configuration steps. Okay, we are now in Visual Studio Code, and you can see I have here a template prepared for the deployment. The template have more lines, so we have here 636 lines to deploy Azure Virtual One, but it's not really hard. So on the left side, you can see all resources. Resources means inside the template, we have defined different resources. One resource is Azure Virtual One. We have our hub configuration. We have a site-to-site VPN configuration. We have the connection for sure for the VPN configuration. Then we have four virtual networks. We have the connection for virtual networks. And at the end, we have the ability to implement site point-to-site VPN too. So let's switch over to our Azure portal and copy this script or this template. Let's go ahead and switch to our resource group. And inside the resource group, we have the ability to switch to the Azure Marketplace. And inside the Azure Marketplace, we can search for the service template. Deployment. Okay. The service gives me the ability to deploy JSON templates. So in this case, this is a JSON template. So we have a self-built template. We built this in our template editor. So let's go ahead, paste my script or my finished template. And on the left side, you can see also all resources which are available inside the template. We also have seven variables and 17 parameters what we need for this template. So click on save and go ahead and fill out the required parameters. First of all, we have to select the subscription, also the resource group. Then we have to define the virtual WAN name and for sure the location for the first virtual WAN hub, the name for the first virtual WAN hub, the IP address segment, and the same for the second virtual WAN hub. And at the end, we have the ability to select more than one scale unit for each virtual WAN hub. And at the end, I give you the ability to deploy a point-to-site VPN too. If you choose this with yes, or if you select yes, you have to add your tenant ID because Azure point-to-site VPN is authenticating over Azure Active Directory, and this is the reason why we need the Azure Active Directory tenant ID. You can find this template on my GitHub account, so feel free, download the template and implement it to your environment. Okay, we are now ready. We are now finished with this session. I hope you enjoyed this session. I hope it was clear for you, and I'm really appreciate if you give me feedback and also subscribe to my YouTube channel. So have a nice day, have a nice weekend, and see you soon.